Hello, and welcome to Spiritual Spectrum. Emerson said, "The greatest man in history was the poorest." And John Zebedee, quoting Jesus, said, "The poor always you have with you." Tonight, we will explore issues dealing with the spiritual and material plight of the poor. Webster says, "Poor is the simple direct term for one who lacks the resources for reasonably comfortable living. Impoverished is applied to one who, having once had plenty, is now reduced to poverty. Destitute implies such great poverty that the means for mere sustenance, such as food and shelter, are lacking." Right now, I'd like to welcome our guests and ask them to introduce themselves and tell us a little bit about themselves. Paula?
My name is Paula Thompson, and I have read and studied the Urantia Book for 13 years now. And it gives me tremendous joy and helps me with my spirituality.
Great, thank you.
Hi, Steve. My name is Dan Sparkman. I'm the pastor of Berkeley Baptist Church and been a minister for 10 years. And my parish is in North Denver. And I've got a strong interest in spirituality because I believe that it is the essence of ministry and helping people and how we relate to the world. I'm married and have two children.
Thanks, Dan. Guru Dasa.
Hi, my name's Guru Dasa. I'm from the Hare Krishna Temple here in Denver. And I've been there teaching and practicing yoga and meditation for the last 10 years. And also involved with developing and starting some of our free food distribution programs that go on here in Denver and in Boulder.
Great, thank you. Okay, what I'd like to do is start out with a question that maybe will get us rolling with our discussion of spirituality and the poor. Is being a spiritual ambassador to God's spiritual kingdom as important as being a social minister to the poor's spiritual needs? Dan, I think you were going to...
Yeah, I think it is. I think when you're trying to do work for the poor and for the weak and powerless, I think it does need to come out of one's relationship to God and one's spirituality. I think many times helping the poor or helping the weak can become just mere activity, but I do believe if it's linked to one's, you know, relationship to God and to one's spirituality, I do believe it gives it meaning. It gives it substance, it gives some content, and I really believe there's a correlation between helping the weak and helping the poor and also where one stands spiritually in his or her own life.
Great, thank you. Paula?
Well, we are spirits living in the material world. The spirit is the supreme reality. It's the only thing that lasts forever. The material is always only temporal. So it's paramount to provide for our spiritual needs. We have spiritual responsibilities as well as material responsibilities. So I think it's even more important, since the spirit is eternal, to provide food for the spirit.
I saw you shaking your head in agreement. Do you have anything to add?
I would agree with that. That's because the soul is the essence of consciousness that makes the body alive. To actually nourish the soul is, in a sense, higher nourishment than nourishing the body. And also, just like, let's say, perhaps a tree. It's a tree. If you want to water all the fruits of the tree or all the branches or leaves of the tree, then you water the root of the tree. You don't try to water all the leaves individually. So similarly, when we tap into the spiritual side of life, automatically material well-being would be there. And so I would say that it's actually more important, in a sense, to deal with the spiritual problems of life than the material problems, but they're parallel. You don't neglect the a man of spiritual consciousness. He has compassion for others, and he therefore, out of his, as you were saying, out of his spiritual consciousness, he wants to help others.
Yeah, I was going to say too. Within the Christian tradition. I know back in the 60s we had a great outpouring of social consciousness and social, trying to meet social needs of race and certainly the poor and the needy and the weakness. But I sense, at least within my perspective, that people are trying to link spirituality with helping the poor and making sure that it has that kind of content, so that one is not just doing it just to spin wheels or feel like it's valueless, but that it has that kind of content of spirituality, connecting with God with it.
So in trying to get back to our topic of spirituality and its relation to the poor, it really seems that they do run real close to each other, both from the standpoint of those who are giving and those who are receiving. Is that something that we can all agree on?
Oh yeah, I think so.
Okay, great. Can a religious group become over-involved in social programs by neglecting its spiritual mission? How does one tie the two together in proper balance? I think that's part of what we were getting to. And Paula, you had...
Oh, I think when you're doing God's work, if that's your motive, and if we realize that we're all God's children spiritually, there again transcending the material level, past the material to the spiritual level, where we are related to God. He's our spirit father, we're His spirit children. And if we set about trying to help our brothers and sisters on this planet that are in need, then I don't think you can overdo that. I guess you could get caught up in maybe some kind of a greed thing or self-interest, self-glorification, and then of course it wouldn't be to service, because it wasn't for your fellow, it was for you. And an organization that gets caught up in glorifying itself could be, you know, going the wrong direction. But as long as they're in the true service mode, I don't think they could ever overdo that.
When we're looking at providing service to the poor, are we doing it to provide the service to the poor, or is it something that we are doing to try to maybe to increase the size of our congregation or the size of the group that believe the way we do? Is there some, do you have a feeling for that, Dan?
I see churches are, certainly within the Christianity, I see churches either who are very involved with social programming, and yet there seems to be neglect of spirituality. It seems like congregations or religious communities either will side one with the other. So that, within my perspective, I believe you got to have a balance, at least within a religious community, like a church. But to achieve that balance, you got to realize that they're both important. But I also believe that you've got to develop one's relationship spiritually with God first, and then out of that comes your concern and your compassion for people to help them materially. I really think there is a flow there that happens.
Mm-hmm. Guru Das, I think that what we're looking at here is, as Dan has said, that we are trying to develop our own spirituality, and as soon as we have, or as we are developing our own spirituality, it's that beginning process of developing that we move out and begin to serve the community. And I think that you've got some interesting ideas that we had talked about earlier about that.
Yeah, actually, everything is sort of based on consciousness. When one is looking at his own self and his own needs, that's considered a very selfish person. So when he becomes a little more advanced, let's say, and he develops kind of a concept of, well, I'll take care of myself and my family members. Mm-hmm. And then he might be a little more broad-minded, and then it'll become his nation, the Americans. I'll help the Americans. But a spiritualist has a little different view. He sees that actually everything, every living entity is connected intimately to the Supreme, to God. So therefore, when he sees anyone, regardless of the color of their skin, regardless of their attire or their social status, he sees them in a spiritual sense, and therefore anyone in need, he will try to gesture some help to. So it's actually, as you were saying, it's actually based Dan was saying, a lot on consciousness, that actually would come first. And there's an interesting story in one of the books of India that talks about a man who was drowning. He was out trying in the midst of great ocean, and he was gasping for air, and he was having a hard time swimming, so a lifeguard saw him and jumped in the water and swam towards him. And when he got to him, he took off all his took off all his clothes and brought the clothes back to the lifeboat, but forgot to save the man. So in a sense, just to administer to the material needs without dealing with the spiritual needs is kind of like that. We're taking care of the body, but we're not taking care of the soul. So both things have to be there, I think.
Right.
The right motivation. And I think that anybody who was in need of help could probably tell what you were motivated by. And it's all important to have that spiritual flavor so that they know you're motivated by love.
Mm-hmm. So our feeling of where our motivation comes from is as important as where we're placing our actions as far as helping others.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Great. Some religionists promote vows of poverty as a means of improving their relationship with God. Others equate material prosperity with spiritual accomplishments. Is there a direct connection between a human's personal relationship with God and his material disposition? Dan?
That's a good question. I certainly would not want to equate prosperity with God's blessing. There is some Old Testament scripture that says that if one is faithful, the material blessings and that kind of thing, spiritual blessings will come. It's like a cause and effect kind of principle. It's, you know, what you sow is what you reap. That kind of plays into it too. I know some deeply spiritual people who are very poor, who don't have much and who are living on fixed incomes or really struggling financially. They don't see their poverty, so to speak, as a curse or whatever, but they somehow have been able to deal with that and develop a strong faith and a strong sense of who they are, identity, spiritually, and so on. I know that in terms of the vows of poverty within at least Catholicism, that it was intentional for one to be rid of material things so that one could draw closer to God through prayer and meditation and you know, walking with God, so to speak, and walking with Christ. So I think in that respect, spirituality can develop, and it has. I know for myself that once I seek God's kingdom in my life first, I don't need to be worrying so much about the material things that I may seek or desire or have, so that, again, there's that focusing. I think that is important.
Okay, I guess one of the things that really hit me with what you said there was we do have people who we perceive as impoverished mm-hmm. or poor in whatever term we choose to use in what term we choose to use there, and yet you still feel that they are very rich spiritually.
Oh yes.
So is there? Do you feel that there's a need there for you or for me or for anyone to try to minister to their poverty, even though you feel that their spirituality is still at a point where it really doesn't maybe need your help?
There's a question here, and really raised it yet, but I think there's an injunction also within the Christian tradition that says that you need to work to provide for yourself and hopefully provide for others in need. I think that's a strong injunction along with just helping the poor. It's more than just giving the poor just a handout. It's also saying we want to equip you to work and to be not only provide for yourself and family, but also be a contributor at large to your fellow beings, to other people around you.
so that in helping people, it's helping them realize that I think that's what, in a sense, God calls people to do, to be accountable and to be stewards and to be creative and to use their imagination and to be not just a receiver, but also a giver.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Paula, comments?
Poor people, I think, it's so much easier for them because they have nothing anyway. So all they have is the spiritual. And their hope of perhaps the more oppressed they are, the poorer they are, the more they need God, the more they need religion, because religion is their hope, their faith, their dream for a better life. And they dwell on that. They gather much strength from that, because what else do they have? Whereas somebody who has everything materially, almost what we would consider heaven on earth, what does the spiritual kingdom mean to them? They don't hunger for ease, they don't hunger for happiness, beauty, all those things they already have, whereas a poor person doesn't have that. And I think it's harder for a rich person to develop a true spiritual sense and a giving, loving sense than it is for a poor person who has nothing, and even what little he has, he would probably share every bit with you because he doesn't put such a great importance on these material things, whereas a rich person probably does. But that's not to say that a rich person can't be motivated spiritually, because of course they can, and it's ideal if they are, because then they can share their great wealth to benefit material life. The Urantia Book, in one section in the teachings of Jesus, he counsels a rich man who's feeling not sure about what he should do with his wealth. And Jesus counsels him that he should put his material wealth back to work to benefit material life. And when you're thinking of material life, it's such a temporal, such a short thing. He said it all when he said, what does it profit a man to gain the whole world only to lose his own spirit? So I think, it's probably more difficult for a rich person to get that spirituality, because they already have such material comforts.
Thank you. That's beautiful. I think one of our other questions that we had talked about was, why do you suppose Jesus and the other world religious leaders started by ministering to the poor? Is it because they are the most neglected or perhaps the most responsive?
When Srila Prabhupada, the founder of the Hare Krishna movement, came to America, many of the yogis who were living in this was during the 60s, 65. Mm-hmm. Many of the yogis who had come here from India and from abroad said, oh, you must go to the Upper East Side of New York. This is where all the wealthy widows are. And where all the aristocratic, and you must change your attire and you must, eat meat like the Americans in order to gain their support. But Srila Prabhupada went to the Bowery. Yeah. He went to the Lower East Side of New York. And that's where he started the Krishna Consciousness Movement in 1965. And he found that because this dissatisfaction of many people with material things at that time and their kind of renounced spirit, they were ready to hear spiritual sounds and spiritual answers to questions.
So your answer is yes, that the...
They're more apt, responsive, mm-hmm. in general, because the wealthy man's proud of his opulence, doesn't think... Even I have experience. I go to the airport and pass out books, and the businessmen walk right by, but if I go down to Five Points and distribute some food, those people are a little more receptive, and that's my experience.
Great. Dan?
Yeah, I was reminded that I think the first sermon that Jesus preached in his hometown was exactly that. He said, he's quoting from the prophet Isaiah, where he says, I've come to proclaim the good news to the poor and proclaim release to the captive. So already within his ministry, he set that agenda, so to speak. As far as, and he did say that it is harder for the rich man to enter the kingdom. And he did say that several times. I think certainly his gospel and his message was open for all, whether it be poor or rich or religious or non-religious or whatever. But certainly within the ministry and the lifetime of Jesus, the poor were more receptive and more certainly willing to hear and to sit at his feet, so to speak, and hear what he had to say. His message basically, confused and it made the religious authorities angry. I mean, there was just no doubt about it. And so already there was a division of who would be receptive to not only him, but also his message. And so certainly Jesus spent a great deal of time with the people who were receptive, and they happened to be the poor, and the prostitutes, and the tax collectors, and other people who were considered marginal in the society.
Great. Thanks, Dan. Okay, we're going to take a short break right here, and we'll be back in 30 seconds.
A billion people live in abject poverty. 40,000 children die each day from malnutrition. The Meals for Millions Freedom from Hunger Foundation teaches underprivileged people to grow the food that will end their hunger forever. Meals for Millions also provides education in nutrition, basic health care, sanitation. I'm Lorne Green. Help hungry people help themselves. Write to Meals for Millions, Box 2000, Davis, California, 95617.
Let's see, where was I? I think we're back, and we're back. I think what I'd like to go into now, we had been talking about the opulence or the wealthy people and they're not being a ready part of the spirituality of some people. They don't feel that. They don't respond as eagerly to the message of any one person as much as a poor person does. And an interesting question, people are generous for many reasons, recognition, guilt for having such an abundance, fear of God's wrath, maybe even hope for God's blessings or good karma. What should be our motives for freely giving as we have received? Paula?
All that comes to mind is Jesus having said, freely have you been given, so freely give. So it's when you're motivated by love, it's a joy to give. It's the greatest pleasure on earth. I mean, nothing really can transcend the joy of service to your fellows, and especially when they're in need. And that's the only motivation that you can, if you have a religious motivation, that's the only motivation you can possibly have, I think, is to be motivated by love of your fellows, to want to see all God's children have a better life. But certainly there's the other reasons, out of guilt and all the things you said, and I'm sure many people do give for those reasons. And I think, though, that whatever reason you begin to give, it'll evolve into a loving and joyful experience because you are actually helping the children of God.
So to give freely is the motivation. The motivation is to give and not to give to get.
Right.
Okay. Dan?
Yeah, I think people also humorously give for tax write-offs.
That's
because
very
of
true.
Uncle Sam, and I think that's another motive, certainly, that is abundant. As Paula was mentioning, I think there are certainly wrong motives and certainly motivations out of guilt or to appease their conscience or what have you. I'm reminded of a story in the Gospel of St. Matthew where Jesus is saying that as you ministered to the weak and you gave a cup of cold water to the person who was thirsty and visited people who were in jail and clothed the naked and the hungry and so on, that you were actually doing it to me. And that's a story of the coming judgment and when we will not be judged necessarily for theological things, but certainly how we reacted and related to our people in need around us. So in some ways, Steve, I believe that proper motive for giving, I think we need to keep in mind is that we give because in some way we're giving, in a sense, to Jesus, to Christ, to God. And again, that is certainly a spiritual motive and certainly something that I'm trying to understand more deeply in my life.
Mm-hmm. Great. Guru Dasa.
Well, I would say that according to one's position, there might be different motives for giving. It's like a person in a government situation. His duty is to make sure that his citizens or his dependents are well fed and clothed. And this is part of the duty of a leader of society. And because, as well as we were just talking about how an impoverished person is more apt to hear spiritual sound vibrations, at the same time, if he's too hungry, he's more thinking about his empty stomach. Mm-hmm. And that's also one of the ways in which the communists would propound communism. They would go to some third world country like India and they would say, see the poverty, and they say, you pray to your God for some food. And then they come back a little later and say, well, is there any food? And then they would say, no. And so they say, you look to us communist friends. And then they pull up a bread truck and start passing out the bread. Mm-hmm. But people never ask, where'd you get the bread? Mm-hmm. You know, where did the rains and where did the wheat and how did this all grow? So the common man sometimes, they're a little bit more just worrying about the basic necessities of life. So therefore, for anyone in a leadership position or a position of ministering or making things happen like that, he can also deal with the basic necessities of food and clothing for the people. And that's why we have some, in Denver, we have some programs like that. For instance, we have a truck that is called the Hare Krishna Food for Life truck, and it travels throughout the city, stopping and distributing free food to the needy at different areas. We go to the Broadway Assistance Center. We go to the Ready Man, temporary work agency. We're distributing food so that people, they can have the necessities of life so they can possibly go on with the progressive spiritual path of life. And in Denver, we distribute about 20,000 plates to 25,000 plates of food a year freely. And internationally, in the last 15 years, we distributed 80 million plates of free food. Very good, healthy, vegetarian, wholesome food. Nothing can.
Oh, that's great.
But that's, you know, we see that as being an important thing, too, that you take care of the material needs of man. And then when he's less worried about that, then hopefully he can become spiritually minded because his belly isn't just aching.
Yeah.
That made me think of the episode where Jesus fed the multitude with the bread and the fishes, and exactly the same thing. They were grumbling and they were very upset and not in a spiritual mind at all. Mm-hmm. And after he fed them, then they calmed down and were much more willing to hear the spiritual message.
Mm-hmm. In fact, didn't they think that the Messiah would be more of a material provider?
Yes, mm-hmm. That more of a political mm-hmm. liberator.
That's right. Because they were in a suppressed condition.
Right.
So sometimes people see religious things as being impractical. I mean, how are you going to answer my problems of life? So when they see that also there's a balance, there's a way of life mm-hmm. where if you live in a certain manner, then the material necessities of life are going to be taken care of as well.
Right. Great. Great. Brings me back to a question that we had talked about earlier. The necessity of labor is one of mankind's paramount blessings. The Hebrews were one of the first tribes to put a premium on industry by saying, "He who does not work shall not eat." Are we helping the poor when we give them something other than opportunity to provide for themselves? Dan?
Yeah, I really believe labor is a gift. I look at the people who are unemployed and they want the opportunity to work. So that labor, I don't see labor in a sense of negative or somehow a curse. I see it as an opportunity or gift from God to be able to labor and to work. I really don't believe that many people who are poor or who are even on welfare, sure, some are not seeking to work and trying to do it, but I would think, and maybe I'm being idealistic, that they would seek work and want to provide for themselves and for others. So that work is a gift, and I think one sees work that way, then one can see it in terms of providing materially, but also being able to contribute to a larger spectrum of the community and the nation, so to speak. There are people who can't work, obviously. I think we need to certainly help them and have a compassionate hearts. But I really think that labor is a gift and ought to be put to use. We are creative, we're imaginative. God has made us with multiple kinds of blessings. And I think certainly anyone can do something with that in terms of labor and work somehow. Maybe I'm just being too overly optimistic about that, but I really believe it's a gift from God to be able to labor.
Having the physical body is a
yes.
real gift, I think.
And certainly the mental capacities, the spiritual capacities, I think they're all part of labor and work. And again, it goes back to the whole doctrine of being stewards and God putting us here as stewards of his earth. And again, it goes back to that understanding, too.
Mm-hmm.
Not to sit around, but to do something creative and do something that will produce, that do something that will help and do something that will contribute overall to God's overall plan.
Mm-hmm. Great.
So that's a good point, I think, too, because I was driving down the street the other day, and it was Colfax and Colorado Boulevard, the crossing. There was a guy in the corner, street corner, says, "I will work for food." Mm. So I realize that people don't necessarily want to just work in a factory, you know, and just to, you know, get all grimy and a chance of losing their limbs and all these things. Mm-hmm. But they want to work in such a way that they can supply the necessities of life. So in a sense, Western society in the Industrial Revolution, not that I'm saying that all those things are bad, but when you take society too much away from an agrarian down to earth mm-hmm. way of life, and you have huge farming apparatuses that producing flour that's sent to the city, it becomes a little imbalanced. Everyone has to live in the city, and you have all this land out there. People could also learn to cultivate the land and to develop a little more self-sufficient concept of life. I think that might be a direction which would be a good idea, a good alternative, as we see the cities are getting more and more congested. And when the city is basically where there's a lot of poor people, mm-hmm. people out of work, and if we can maybe get back into a little more idea of living a little more connection to nature and producing our own food, I think that might be a valuable alternative.
Yeah. I think it's a little unfortunate. In the city, it's much easier to find, obviously, more people.
Mm-hmm.
When there's more people, there's more commerce, there's more consumption that's happening by the majority. And then I think with that consumption, we have, in a Western society, we have a lot of waste, and I think that because of that, there are people that are actually able to sustain themselves off of what's left over, basically. And I think that you wouldn't find something like that if you were in a small community. I understand your point, but I think that the reason that we have a lot of poor people, or that they hang around mostly in the cities, is because there's just more of an opportunity for survival here. Dan, you had something you wanted to say?
Yeah, I was going to say the correlation with that. What Das was saying was that the amount of the poor that's happening with our farmers, as we get more urbanized, it takes the capital, it takes people away from, as you say, the farms, and so that there's a new poor group, and that's our farmers, which is unfortunate because they are the ones who sustain, you know, our food economy. But that's a new phenomenon that's going on. We've witnessed that the last 3 to 5 years. So that along with women and children and of course certain minorities, we have now the farmers who are becoming impoverished and cannot, you know, they have to end up selling their homes and their farms, and that's really unfortunate.
It's kind of harsh the way the Hebrews said it, he who does not work shall not eat, and that sounds real cold-blooded in this society because so many people are out of work, and certainly it would be society's burden to try and employ those people or find adequate employment for them. But then on the other hand, you have the people who really aren't inclined to work, really would rather live and have a free ride. And certainly then this admonition, he who does not work shall not eat, is true, because somebody who is perfectly able-bodied and able to work but doesn't contribute anything is a parasite. And they're sucking the life out of those of us who do work. So everybody has to contribute something. If they can't, that's one thing. If they're blind or disabled or whatever reason, you know. But certainly any job that anybody, I get the feeling a lot of times that certain jobs are, you know, you're too good for them. You know, people think they're too good to do that. But that's not true. Any job is needed, any job is necessary. And I agree with you wholeheartedly that it's a gift. Any employment that you can do is a gift, and it's your gift to the world, to the operation of the whole, the smooth operation of the whole. So I have to agree with that. If a person is able-bodied and can work and doesn't, then the penalty should be, you know, you don't eat, you don't survive.
Yes.
I just have a reflection on that. In a sense, it's also, there's a problem, because our society, in American society, we put so much value on economic development. Like I remember when I was in college, my guidance counselor says, don't study philosophy, you'll never make a living at it. So, in a sense, we reward people who work in a certain manner, and there's no reward for people who work in another manner. So, there's a little bit of an imbalance, mm-hmm. too, in an overly economic, capitalistic society, that there's going to be people who are impoverished, and there's going to be people who are going to be very wealthy simply by that system. So I think there has to be a little more awareness of how all sectors of society are not necessary for the society to be healthy. And then you'll see that people who have trades, sometimes we go to these ready-man workplaces to distribute food, and they're just temporarily out of the job. They're trying to get work, but they've lost their job due to the force of circumstances. So we come and they very much appreciate that we're helping them in their difficult time with some free food. But we've also found that those people, they have some trade that just has become somewhat unnecessary in society. It's not they're not willing to work and not willing to put out. So we have to, like, as a society, also become a little more balanced. We can't just pay, in my opinion, this might be a little radical, we can't just pay a lawyer middle six figures and then someone, a teacher, $20,000 a year. Mm-hmm. It becomes an imbalance, and then everyone views life in an economic manner.
True.
And then
true.
You create yeah. class divisions.
Yeah. We put a floor on things, but we don't put a ceiling on them.
Interesting. One of the points I think that you brought up in one of our questions was Jesus is quoted as saying not to cast pearls before swine. How important is being prudent and economical in both material and spiritual ministries? Is there a real need for us to watch where we throw our pennies, watch where we put our food, to make sure that it's going in the right direction? Do you have a feeling for that, Dan?
Well, personally, the ones that I've worked with, for example, I'll just tell you out of my own experience in my church. When people come to us off the street with for gas money or for any kind of food allowance or whatever, cash allowance, we do try to help them with those, like especially food.
Mm-hmm.
But we also check that person, so to speak. We find out who he is, where he lives, what his family condition is, so that he's not abusing or misusing, quote, our generosity, so to speak. Most people are legitimate needs. Some have, you know, some just come because they are just in dire straits at that time. But we have found a few people that go to certain churches or certain organizations, or it could be Salvation Army, to maybe even to your situation, and misuse love, misuse generosity, misuse this supporting system, instead of trying to get the jobs, or trying to get skills, or trying to get out of that cycle of just abuse. Mm-hmm. So I think we do need to be prudent, and I think the fact that labor is a gift, and money and everything is a gift, we do need to be careful and prudent about how we share it.
Great, thank you. We're going to take a break now. If you would, grab a pencil and a piece of paper, and you can, when we come back, we'll be giving you our address and phone number, and we'll be right back.
The American Pilgrims. In the 1600s, these determined men and women, so few in number, conquered the hostile wilderness and began a new life of freedom and democracy for themselves and all who followed. The great American wild turkey was abundant in those days and was not only one of the pilgrims' main food sources, but was served at their first Thanksgiving feast. The neighboring Indians were invited to share this holiday with the pilgrims and to commemorate their harvest, and the Feast of Thanksgiving became one of our country's most cherished traditions. No wonder Benjamin Franklin proposed the wild turkey be our country's symbol. However, land clearing in the 1800s made this powerful bird almost extinct. But the wild turkey has made a comeback over the past several years thanks to careful wildlife management, a tribute to American conservation efforts. You can help keep the legendary American wild turkey alive. Write Wild Turkey, Box 530, Edgefield, South Carolina.
And we're back. And we were speaking about poverty. And I think that you had some more that you wanted to add to what Dan was saying about
being prudent.
About being prudent.
Yeah, actually, it's nice because in certain cities of the United States, the Hare Krishna movement has got government funds to help with their food distribution program and help with their shelters. We have a shelter in two shelters in Philadelphia that were inaugurated by Mayor Good, and we get federal funds city funds in both Detroit and Cleveland. And there was a statement made in the press that they said they'd like to give a dollar to the Hare Krishna movement for its food distribution because they can take that dollar and make it go so far. Because within our organization, everyone works as a volunteer, and we're self-sufficient in terms of our own church. We don't use the funds. Those funds, we can completely utilize that for food distribution or the shelter. And it's amazing how much in this society, how much food surplus there actually is. There's food banks that are stocked, completely stocked, with tons of butter and raisins and products, bulk foods, that simply can just be transformed into food. Well, there's no shortage of food. And there's actually in America, it's a funny thing, because our Indian community has developed a program where they're collecting the older, not so much used clothing, and they're distributing them to the needy in America, which is a little interesting that the Indians do that to Americans.
That's great.
But I just want to say it's true when you get into a big bureaucratic organization, maybe there's a lot of misuse. But we've actually found by being small and local that you can do a lot within your community in a very efficient way. Mm-hmm. We could take a small amount of money and turn it into a lot of food and distribute a lot of the necessities of life to people for some, what we would consider a night on the town. We can turn that into up to food products for distribution. So I think that would be a good way.
That's very interesting.
Yeah, North Denver, that reminds me, North Denver, we have numerous churches from all the different kinds of traditions giving toward a large food bank in North Denver, so that, you know, that's our way cooperatively try to give food to the poor and to the needy, to the weak in our community. So that works well, and we all know that that's a need. That's the way we do ministry together, and it links us up together in that kind of food ministry.
And you feel that there's the prudence in there, the economics of
yes.
being able to serve more people with fewer dollars?
Yeah, that food bank has a board, and it's monitored by the board, and that board is represented by the different churches and parishes in North Denver, so that it is monitored carefully, and they do keep a check on every recipient that comes into that food bank. And of course, not just the getting back to the spirituality thing too, Steve, it's also how can we help spiritually this family,
sure.
this elderly couple, or this unwed mother, or whoever that person is.
Right. Great. Getting back to your comment on being able to go a long ways with a dollar, we had a question, if I can find it. If you could feed one poor American a meal for a dollar, or 10 poor Afrikaners for the same price, how does one decide spiritually who should be fed, since all men are our brothers? I think we had discussed the fact that we are all brothers, and it makes it tough. Do we start at home, or do we find the most economical place to place our dollar?
Well, myself, if I could give the American the meal and know for certain that the American was getting to eat, then I would probably do that rather than send my dollar away and not know for sure if it was ever going to reach its destiny. So charity, and I believe charity begins at home. It's a circle that grows. And if everybody operated in a 20-mile radius and said, I'm going to make that radius better and help the people in that radius and then branch out from there, so it's sometimes it's more effective and a lot easier to help the person next door than it is to help the person overseas.
So we're being prudent and we're being economical at the same time, is that?
I guess you could say that.
Okay, great.
I was listening to a program just a couple nights ago, I think it was Nightline. They were talking about the destruction, massive destruction in Bangladesh right now.
Mm-hmm.
And I believe our government's going to send over billions of dollars to help the people there. And unfortunately, you know, about 20 or 30% of that entire money will probably just go to the people who have lost their homes, who've lost their relatives, their loved ones, whatever. And the government officials and people who will be going, all the middle people are going to somehow extract that money that needs to be going to the people who really need it. And that's, again, part of the problem, the government, you know, supporting. I think we need to help the people that are within our circle. And I think what Paula was saying was that there are people that we know, that I know, that my family knows, that my people in my church know. If we can help those people, and first, because that's I sense that's our responsibility, and helping them and making sure they're, so to speak, taken care of and dealt with. Then, if we can help others, certainly. But I think our first stewardship ought to be the people that within our own sphere of our lives.
Great, and I think we basically got your answer to the whole question. Is you're helping at home? Is that
also? The Hare Krishna movement is worldwide, so we do a lot of help in places where they have floods, and the Philippines and in Bangladesh were present, and in Africa. But a lot of times, almost everywhere you go, there's the wealth. There is a certain class of people who are wealthy. So in our centers, our Krishna centers around the world, they're very autonomous, and then they'll approach the wealthier people of that area, and they'll try to develop food programs, or they try to give some crisis help to a situation like a large flood or something like that. And we have also gotten funds from UNICEF mm-hmm. and government organizations, because we are very local as well. So we try to work on a global issue, but it's all a matter of priorities again. I mean, a government that can spend one-third of its income on military, I mean, that says something about our priorities.
That it does.
One-third of its budget. And, I mean, what better foreign policy than teach people how to develop their land and develop their own trades and their mm-hmm. own products, rather than, I mean, that's what they're looking for. That's why they might turn to an alternative governmental system, because they're having problems with those things.
And we didn't really want to get into the government socio-political side of this, but I really think that now may be a good point. Do you feel that we obviously have a different class of poor here than we do, than there are in India, mm-hmm. or even if you were to go to some place like Portugal? Go ahead.
Well, I was just thinking, it was interesting because now India is selling rice to America.
Is that right?
They're beating the prices here.
Ah, so it's the economics more than it is the production.
Because they're self-sufficient in terms of their own, the grains that they produce.
Uh-huh.
But the poverty that exists is due to mismanagement. It's actually due to, that's an interesting concept in the Indian culture, the Indian concept of, not Indian, but the Vedic mm-hmm. scriptural idea of government and the structure of society, is that the priestly class of men is like the head of society. Mm-hmm. And they give direction to society because they're not self-motivated. Because their giving mm-hmm. is out of a sense of just out of giving because they see the need and they're loving. So, but what happens is when, as you said, that politicians and self-interest party get involved, and there's all kinds of problems. Mm-hmm. So in the Vedic culture, the leaders, the guidance of society comes from the saintly men. And then, therefore, the administrators are guided by them. Mm-hmm. They administer according to their instruction. This is very idealistic. But it can be applied, and it should be at least sought after. That's what we shoot for, right? Ideals. And then the mercantile men, they support. They have the ability for trading and for making money so that they can support the economic base, and then it's distributed a little bit more equally. It's a little bit of a different
system,
concept.
Yeah.
Than just, you know, whoever can acquire the most economic power controls things, mm-hmm. and the supply and the demand, and it just gets all complicated.
Mm-hmm. Sure. I think you had a
thought. Well, I just, what you were saying made me think of what Jesus said to his apostles when they were arguing with each other about who would sit at the head of the table next to him. And he said, he who is truly great among you, he is the one who will serve. Mm-hmm. And he proceeded to wash all of their feet, and they were repelled by that. The master would wash their feet, and it was almost unthinkable. Mm-hmm. And yet here he was, wonderful, glorified being that he was, incarnate as a man among men, serving us to his utmost every day of his life. Mm-hmm. Supreme example, and truly leadership will have come a long way when it is motivated by the love of it, you know, the good of the whole, right. and the love of fellows, and not motivated by self-glorification or power or whatever. Mm-hmm. Whatever trip they're on, I don't know, sometimes.
That's great. Any other comments? I think we're about ready to wrap up here. Is there anything that anyone would like to? I think that we've gotten pretty much our spirituality and how poverty and spirituality spirituality can work for trying to alleviate poverty, and I think that poverty does begin at home. Anything else anyone would like?
Well, the Urantia book talks about love as a divine virus. And so just as hatred and poverty can be self-perpetual, so can love and generosity and charity. And so it's not so much important that we go out and accomplish tremendous things and feed the world or as it is that we resolve every day to help somebody that we know that's in need. And it's a lot easier for you to help a person you know, and everybody knows somebody. And by giving that gift, then that person in turn gives that gift to someone else who's in need when they get on their feet. Or so it is a divine virus. It keeps growing and growing and growing, and one day it'll fill the world. The most important thing that a person can do right now to help the poor is to minister to somebody who's poor. And everybody, I think, knows someone. Even no matter what circles you travel in, there's somebody that we can minister to that needs us and needs our charity and our kindness and our love.
Great. Thank you. Thank you. Dan?
Yeah, I think it's really appropriate to link spirituality and the poor. I think it's very appropriate. I believe that helping people who are poor, who are weak and powerless, as I said before, it comes out of one's spirituality, one's relationship to God. I know in my own case, as I draw closer to God in my own life, I'm more compassionate and more empathetic and willing to extend His hands to those around me. So I think it's really appropriate to think of those two together.
Great. Anything you'd like to say?
I would just say, in closing, that it's important to address these questions from not only the practical point of view, but as we have been discussing, the philosophical or spiritual point of view, so that we can find some ideals to direct ourselves towards as a society. And that everything is based upon pleasing God and developing the spiritual side of life. As we direct in that way, then the other things will also become nourished.
Great, thank you very much. I'd like to thank all of you for joining us this evening. And I'd like to thank you for participating with us in our discussions of the poor. And please tune in next time to Spiritual Spectrum, when we will explore the current trends in today's spiritual issues. Good night.